Hello, my name is Athena Panagopoulou. I'm a lawyer. We are here to discuss the developments in the NPL market, a subject that was discussed in almost every panel here today. We have with us Mr. Theodoros Athanasopoulos, Executive General Manager of Non-Performing Loans Wholesale Banking of Alpha Bank. Mr. George Yorgakopoulos, Executive General Manager, Non-Core Business and Structured Portfolio of Piraeus Bank. Mr. George Katsikas, Executive Director, Financial Institutions Group of UBS London. And Mr. Dimitrios Psaris, Partner of Oliver Wyman. And Dr. Martin Tsouta, CEO of the Hellenic Financial Stability Fund. So there has been increasing interest in the NPL market, and it looks like the market is finally opening up. The first transaction under the new legal framework for NPLs has been concluded between Eurobank and Intrum, and more transactions are on the way. The Hellenic Stability Fund is monitoring the progress being made in the market. Martin, will you give us an insight of the role of the HFSF and how you're assisting the banks in their targets to effectively manage their NPL exposures?
Thank you. The HFSF is playing a major role, and I found it interesting that George from McKinsey also mentioned us, because we have, let's say, various levels where we can be active. But let me tell you a little bit about the HFSF, because I'm not sure that everyone knows what HFSF stands for apart from Hellenic Financial Stability Fund. The Hellenic Financial Stability Fund, the Tukusu in Greek, was founded in 2010. And that was a compromise solution. And then the fund was very small in the beginning. Then the recapitalization came, 13, 14, 15, and the fund became more and more important. Now the fund is a shareholder in the four systemic banks, has 40% in NBG, has 27% in Piraeus, has 11% in Alpha, and 2% in Eurobank. And now we have the role of bringing stability into the financial system to make the banks profitable, sustainable from a long-term perspective. And NPL, NPE is one of our functions we are destined to assist the banks with. But that's not the only part. We also take care of the corporate governance and all of this. And we are part of the Hellenic Cooperation and assets and participations, although we do not report. We are 100% owned by the Ministry of Finance, and we have a strong influence from the European institutions. That means they are on our General Council, which is the supervisory board, and with the observers from the Commission and from Frankfurt and from Luxembourg, from the ESM. So this is just an intro in what we are doing. And on the NPL front, we are issuing every year a report on the NPL impediments. And the most important one was the one in 2015, because that one led to material changes in the law, in the bankruptcy law, in the civil code, in the NPL law, in all of those. And there was a report, an update, 2016, and the latest one will be issued very soon. We just have to go through our supervisory board, which will be next week, and by the end of the year, it will be on our website. There are still impediments, even for the changed law, but the biggest steps were done already, and that's the bankruptcy law, that's the civil code, which means for the e-auctions, bankruptcy law, which defines roles and makes some issues very, very easy, or relatively easy, let's put it this way. And also for the out-of-court framework, that was also done. And we are also an observer in the MPL committee, which is organized by the Banking Association. We're giving our input there. And by the law, we have special rights where we can monitor and we can instruct the banks. They are the RFAs, the Relationship Framework Agreements, and we are a shareholder where we have frequent meetings with the board of directors, with the management, so we can give them our views how the MPL and MPE solutions should be done.
Thank you. Now, from the bank's perspective, Thodoris, can you please update us on the progress that have been made so far by the banks in the key areas considered as building blocks related to the development and implementation of the NPL strategy? What are the technical issues that the banks are facing when selling NPLs, and how are these resolved? And are the banks ready to meet the expectation of the investors?
Well, thank you from my part. I think when looking at what the Greek banks have done in terms of NPL, one should take into account where they started for and what is the macro environment. Of course, one can comment that the pace of NPE reduction in the system is good but not adequate and it has to accelerate. But on the other hand, we have to bear in mind that the banks have been operating under an unforeseen crisis for Greece, which is lengthy. The banks went through a consolidation period whereby not only did they consolidate themselves, but they also operationally changed internally by creating four internal, we can say, non-core units with quite an operational struggle to invest on technology, set up processes and policies, and actually adhere with the problem during the recession. And of course, since the last 2 years, one has to take into account that the economy retained the negative GDP reduction with a cumulative drop of 30%. The banks have operated under a capital under a capital controls regime. That being said, in a very challenging environment, the banks in the last year have submitted business plans to the SSM for the reduction of NPEs, and they have managed to decelerate from NPLs, but at a slow pace, and this year has been inevitably been dominated by write-offs on parts of the book which have been liquidated in the past. On the other hand, the judicial framework, as Mr. Giuda said, has been recently changed. I think we are at a level in terms of legal regime that we are not perfect, but we can transact and we can start operating. And bear in mind that we are talking about NPL resolution in an economy in recession whereby no auction actually took place in the last years. This is important not just because of the recoveries that one can get through the auction, but it's quite important to recreate a payment behavior in Greece. Having said that, it is evident that we are talking about a very clear environment, a very difficult environment that the banks operated, which was more of operational and target setting and building up business plans, which were only performed in 2017. If we compare with other jurisdictions, and we're going now to the investor community, we'll understand that the banks until this year, they had not the ability to proceed with portfolio sales. Not only because there was no legal framework regime in place, but also due to the fact that there were no services in the market. So you can understand an NPL resolution in an economy where more than 50% of the GDP is actually invested, if I may say, in NPLs, with no services and no market-based transactions. Are the banks going to use this kind of solutions, market-based solutions? I think from the report coming out from Bank of Greece, we'll see that in a total NPE reduction of almost 40 billion in the next 3 years, we see that the banks have targeted 30% of this reduction coming out with portfolio sales. The first sale took place by Eurobank end of this year, and all the four banks are following with transactions the first quarters of unsecured credit. So unless we had all these changes within the banks, segmentation, business plans, build-up of coverage, of course, and impairment levels and granular strategies, but also a framework, I think we would not be in a position to discuss about NPE reduction. In that sense, given that the macro situation is improved, we see that on the GGB yields, one can assume that the bid-ask spread between banks will banks and investors will gradually go out because certain uncertainties exist. But there is a big challenge for the banks, and the challenge is that they work granularly on the portfolios. The quality of information that they put forward to the investment community is such that allows for the investor to take a logical, let's say, assumption on the value of the portfolio and that the strategies can develop. And of course, the banks have to tap the market with a clear signal that they are willing to transact, which means that if the banks should prepare the portfolios and work with their advisors to have a clear understanding of the value proposition and not withdrawing the market and leaving the market or the investors after a clear investment that they made. We saw the first corporate NPL trade in December. We are currently on the process of selling the fish farming sector and, of course, also selling a large telecommunication company, and we think that these transactions, alongside with the portfolios that are going to tap the market, are quite important to be well prepared and will signal the market. If these transactions are efficient and they conclude, I think gradually the relationship between the banks and the investors will ameliorate, and we will have a clear signal to the investment community.
Thank you very much. Now, from the bank's perspective again, there are other high NPL jurisdictions that face similar problems as Greece. We have seen more progress in these jurisdictions, in some of the jurisdictions. What are they doing differently?
Okay, I think, Thenia, thank you. If I may take a few seconds just to introduce myself, my name is Georgios Jakopoulos. Been now with Piraeus Bank for the last 2 months. Before that, I'm a long-term banker. Before that, I was for 22 years with Barclays, mostly in Western Europe. I did a few years with Eurobank in Eastern Europe, and I was most recently the CEO of Eurobank in Romania, and then the chief executive of a company called 4Finance, which does digital lending. So I spent all my working career actually outside of my home country. So going back the last 2 months, I asked myself a couple of times the question, but hey, many other countries seeing it from the outside, you see? Many other countries had issues. Spain had issues, Portugal had issues, Ireland had issues, Cyprus had issues. Why are all those countries, you know, back in the black now and growing at the time my home country is not doing, is not anywhere in that same trajectory? I think the first thing here to, if you start digging into it, you see, the first thing you find out, I think, rather easily, is that, well, actually, the Greek financial crisis is much, much deeper. And it, the recession or depression, as somebody in a panel called it earlier today, has lasted for much, much longer. If you look at the crisis in Spain that I happen to know quite well, actually, is it related primarily to one type of asset, real estate, which is relatively easier to solve because, you know, you wait for the price takes, you know, the right level, and then the problem sort of solves itself out. Of course, some people have lost money on the way, which is equity holders, banks, etc. But it is a lot more focused, concentrated, contained or containable type of problem. Now, this is not the case for Greece. Greece lost 30% of its GDP in a couple of years. And actually, the GDP level in the country now is the same as it was in 1999, you know, 20 years back. So it has got, you know, very deeply into recession. Or consumption today, or investment today, actually is lower than it was in 1999. So it has lost a lot of its financial strength and power. It has seen unemployment up to 28%. Thankfully, now is much lower and decreasing. It has seen house prices falling from 102 to 58. Thankfully, now it is stabilizing, so it is good news. So it has suffered a much deeper type crisis. In addition, I don't hear it discussed that much, but has gone through a deep banking crisis as well as a result of the credit and liquidity crisis. I think about 12 banks got liquidated, which is not something that happens every day in Europe. Therefore, much deeper and wider type crisis. Now, what Greece did not do very well, and I think Theodoris alluded a bit on it actually, is that the banks could have moved a bit faster probably, could have set up specialist units a bit earlier. They only did that in 14. And one can say, hey, the legal environment was a bit too slow to adapt. We heard today that it took up to 14, 15, you know, for the, or even actually this year, 17, for a couple of legislative measures critical for this business to go through and get implemented. Now, the good news is that they are now implemented. So what is different? Well, what has been different is that Greece had a depression, the others did not. And Greece ended up with 45% and 50% NPEs of the banking books, of the banking system. If you look at the financials and compare it with other European countries, the second group is about 20, and most countries are well below 10. So the problem is much, much bigger, much, much deeper. But now, I think we are in quite a good place. I will not repeat what everybody said, you know, so far, i.e. the developments on GDP, consumer sentiment, PMI indexes, and so on and so forth, which are all important. I would say more narrowly, in terms of how the banking system is prepared, now the units, the right units in the banks are in place, and I have responsibility, among other things, for one of them in the largest banking group, which is Piraeus Bank. The legal framework is adequate, can be improved, but it is adequate, and it is there. And there is an ecosystem of support services, being that legal services, liquidating type services, servicers themselves, for the loans, etc. On a bit deeper now, and moving forward on how, you know, the issue can be solved. You know, take the premise that we speak about 100 billion plus NPEs, and actually we have 32 of them. And how do you deal with them? I think the answer is you deal with them only one way, which is decisively. This is how you have to deal with them. And Theodoris said, you know, I'm sure this is the case for all other banks, not only for Piraeus and Alpha. You know, the banks do have plans how to get rid of them decisively and deal with them decisively. Specifically, what we are going to do, and I believe others will as well, we will do deeper and decisive restructurings, and this to start with financial type restructurings. We said it publicly, we said it in the last investor call that they participated as well, that we intend to do 10 times more deep restructurings in the business portfolio, and our portfolio is two-thirds business, than we did previously. Of course, this has a number of implications, including losses for us, but they're budgeted for, expected, and provided for. Secondly, it's not enough that the banks do their own part, because you see, and this is what the colleague from McKinsey was saying before, if you look at the landscape deeper, you find out that the companies do not only need financial restructuring, i.e. they need to make the debt sustainable. They need more than that usually. What they need more is they need probably different management, control systems, strategy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the banks, we can be a catalyst for those changes to take place, but we cannot do them ourselves, you know, only. We need the companies to participate. Now, very good news, and that would be my final point here. What other countries saw to help them solve the situation of the NPEs, so inflow of foreign capital coming in to assist with the reduction and dealing with them. We see very good signs in Greece as well. What we see right now is we see very strong interest in purchase of NPLs. Actually, we, Piraeus Bank, we are running, as we speak, two transactions, one 1.5 billion secured, corporate and SME, and one another half a billion unsecured, and we have very, very strong interest. On the secured part, we have 30 plus NDA signed investors looking into our data. So there is interest in the transactions. Very good start. Secondly, we see very strong interest in private equities and strategic investors who are prepared to come in and put money to deeply restructure companies. We are running a number of processes, usually with other banks as well. Telecom sector, medical sector, real estate, etc. We see interest from investors to come in and recapitalize the target entities and restructure them, which is absolutely necessary. And thirdly, we see interest in the real estate investment as well. We have quite a bit of portfolio, obviously. We're quite a bit of a good test case, whether there is interest, and there is. So all in all, the case has been very different in that specific country compared to others. Much deeper issue. Quite a few structural things had to change. Most of them have been changed. What we need now is decisiveness from all parties involved. I think this is mostly in place. And we need capital as well, and this seems to be forthcoming too.
Thank you. George says that there is an interest from investors. Do you share this view? Is there investors' appetite? What are the asset types and volumes that are of interest to investors? And what are the key challenges for extracting value from the NPL assets?
Sure. Thank you very much, Tanya. First of all, I certainly confirm and on behalf of my institution that we do see a lot of interest for Greek NPEs across the board. Unfortunately, our system can offer, you know, SMEs, retail, secure, unsecure, across all the products. And we can see incrementally people coming down to Athens and trying to assess the opportunity. And we have actually many live transactions in the market, and most of the big, well-known international firms being in Athens and conducting due diligence, which is an extremely positive sign. Now, obviously, the catalyst in terms of asset types, as you mentioned, Tanya, we expect to be the CRE-backed NPLs rather than the, so to speak, low-hanging fruit, which is the retail highly covered exposures. And we have not seen a transaction of this nature yet in Greece. We have seen, obviously, Eurobank's unsecured trade. The other banks are in the market for the same type of product. You know, the interesting is the result of the secured NPEs, which is the real sort of catalyst in the overall NPE resolution and will tangibly impact the economic recovery of SMEs or larger corporates. Obviously, you know, putting that into context, we should all remember what all the Greek banks have dealt with over the past couple of years, over the past probably 5 to 7 years, and NPE resolution appears to be the last obstacle in this very tough journey, and in combination with the SSM targets, which are very strict, and they have to be. To be executed perfectly by the end of 2019, we do expect incremental activity starting from the first quarter of 2018 and obviously being intensified all the way until the end of 2019. But also further, because banks have gone further and they have sort of extrapolated, if I may, the SSM targets to 2020 and onwards, aiming to fully cleaning up their balance sheets. This is not going to be, obviously, an easy sort of value extraction exercise for all the NPE investors. But once the legal framework, which is now there, and it's very important, once it gets traction, we do expect to see a lot of value extraction and win-win situations for all the stakeholders.
There is a very interesting initiative called the Solar Project. And I think Dimitris will tell us more about this, the goals of this initiative, the description of the process, and the types of assets involved, and the progress made so far.
Thank you, Tanya. Hi, everyone. So my name is Dimitris Paris. I'm a partner with Oliver Wyman in London, and I'm responsible for for serving our Greek and Cypriot clients. I think as we've been working with the Greek banks over the last few years, we've been working mostly on their individual NPE strategy. And their own operating model. I think both in the CEO panel that earlier today, as well as the presentation we just saw, one word was mentioned loud and clear, which is collaboration. I think the industry started realizing that cross-bank collaboration is particularly important in resolving the issue, with particular focus on difficult NPE segments. We saw in the previous presentation the ferries industry. I think one other industry I'm about to talk about is the SME segment, segment of the industry. And I'm not going to go into details on why SMEs or small and medium-sized enterprises are difficult to be managed. I guess you all are aware. There are many. The information about them is not there due to the lower reporting requirements. And at the same time, they're not that much easier to actually be resolved. They still require some turnaround and restructuring skills from specialists. Importantly, though, most of those customers in Greece are multi-banked. So they actually have exposure with more than one banks, which creates an extra layer of complexity as there are different incentives among banks based on the position, the collateral liens, and so on and so forth. So I think there's a slide that I was promised and a clicker, which I don't have. Okay, there you go. So I think before we go into the details, it's basically just a single page I'd like to show you, and I would like to say that I'm also speaking under the control of George and Theodore, because this is genuinely probably the first private sector-led, industry-wide NPL management initiative that we've seen in Europe. So how it started is last May, together with the banks, we kicked off this project called Solar, which aimed to answer two main questions. Question number one is there merit in collaborating in managing those SME clients? And if the answer to that question is yes, could this work? Could we make it happen? So on the first question, and before we go to the details, we analyzed the entire SME NPE universe of Greece, and it quite quickly became clear, even before the summer break, that the platform would be additive. And we observed some interesting things. For example, time to restructure was directly correlated with the number of banks involved. So the more banks involved in the process, the more time it took for a company to be restructured. So collaboration would increase speed. We also found specific clients that would be considered viable by some of the banks, but non-viable by some other banks. And that was both an issue of different definitions within the banks, as well as different information availability. The third is collaboration of the banks would increase cooperation of the clients. We actually found a lot of clients that were only cooperating with one of the banks, so they were somewhat gaming the system. And lastly, costs. Banks are paying for advisors or for auditors to do IBRs, for lawyers, for the same clients. So managing them together will also generate synergies. So very quickly, we conclude with the banks, and if we can, I don't know, Thenia, if you have the clicker or someone can move to the actual page, next page. So after we were all convinced that there is actually merit in collaborating, the immediate next step was to figure out a way to make this work. So we changed a lot of names together with the banks. We called it a virtual bad bank or a collaboration platform or a restructuring platform, and we ended up just calling it Solar just to make sure we all knew the same thing. But essentially, starting from the right, the first step was to identify the perimeter. We're talking about 25 billion of SMEs. We concluded to a perimeter that is sizable but manageable. We aimed for an initial perimeter of 2 to 3 billion, which consists of relatively big clients that are largely operational, as we all agreed that the main value out of this platform would be to turn non-viable clients in the eyes of the banks to actually viable clients through injecting new funding. Then the second step after identifying the perimeter was to align the banks into creating a single restructuring platform. So we had to co-create and be a little bit inventive there together with the banks on a number of areas. And the primary objective was that all four banks would benefit from the upside on a portfolio level, and on a debtor level would not be worse off than the liquidation scenario. So the platform would actually only provide upside to the banks. We developed a common recovery strategy in the form of a common credit policy for those banks, aligned on segmentation criteria, viability criteria, and definitions and treatments for those customers. We agreed on an interbank governance framework, which is hopefully will prove to be simple and efficient. So the decision-making process is extremely streamlined. It doesn't involve going back to the bank's committees. It essentially provide some delegated authority to the platform. And we developed together with the banks a set of methodologies and rules on how the proceeds would then feed back to the banks. So how would these proceeds from all possible solutions that we designed together be reallocated back to the four banks? And then we designed the structural elements of the platform, such as who is going to be providing the services, who is actually going to be owning the platform, how new funding will come into the play, et cetera. So we concluded all of this during the summer, and as you perhaps have heard, that this process has been running since the autumn, where we detailed the operational, some of the operational components further to make sure that there are no legal or operational impediments that we might have missed. We have run an extensive RFP process to identify a servicer. We're down to three services, and hopefully before year end, the banks will have agreed on selecting one that will run the platform. And we're now in the last print before Christmas, so that in Q1 we can then start operationalizing together with a selected servicer this platform.
Thank you. I have 5 minutes, unless anybody wants to say something more, we can answer questions if there are any.
When it comes to restructuring, can you actually go in and put in new management, fire and hire, sell assets? I mean, are you free to go in and do what's necessary?
I think let me take it, and Thodoris, who is a long-standing practitioner in Greece, can add up. I think, yes, there are tools today with special administration type rules, and you can get in and you can take control of it. I think I would say it's more a question of is a commercial bank, because this is what we are, the right party to go and do that. The answer is, I think, can be a catalyst for that. If you need deeper changes, including capital structure, my personal preference is to see how we partner with industry players, being that private equity firms and or sector industry players, you know, ideally with the right expertise, to come in and do the restructuring. So yes, the tools are largely there, could be improved. Question is how you do it. I think you do it with the right partnership, and we have quite a few cases working as we speak in fish farming, telecoms, medical, real estate. As we speak, we're cutting deals.
No, I share the view that the toolkit is wider and it is there, but there are practical issues. For example, Joe said we can use this special liquidation process, which seems to be dominating the market for non-cooperative borrowers and management, which is a liquidation process, which at the same time means that it's not so, let's say, efficient on sectors whereby suppliers' credit is quite high, because at the end of the day, you liquidate and you might lose the going concern just because the suppliers will cut off. So this is one problem, and the problem is that we are lacking legal processes for non-cooperative management. The corporate law in Greece is quite protective for shareholders, even in the case that they have zero equity or negative equity. The second thing is, one stepping in, is the management liability, and I'm not referring to the bank executive's liability, but I'm referring to the management itself. So if you step in as a CEO in Greece into a medium to large-sized company, you might end up, if the restructuring fails, being liable for the tax and social security claims that might arise. This is a very big problem in terms of talent, to my mind, because some of these restructurings will succeed, some of these restructurings will fail. And in a small economy like Greece, we might have 170 billion of GDP, but once you want to attract talent and get the best of management, either yourself or, as I agree with George, in partnership with private equity firms that know how to do that, because the commercial banks, they don't know. This is a big impediment for practitioners and CEOs that want to undertake. So I think the overall statement is that the banks are more decisive to do things like that. We saw that in 2017. We've seen some liquidations, and we've seen some transactions with investors that actually moved into a change of control. We are lacking a clear and fast process for non-cooperative managements, which usually there's a corporate governance issue because they're management and shareholder and they are acting as a shareholder rather than management. And one thing that should be definitely tapped, and I'm taking out because this is not the, the platform to discuss it, I'm taking out the bank employees' liability. One thing that should definitely be addressed is the liability of professional management teams when running a business. This is quite important either for us or for the private equity investment. We are better, but we have things to do going forward.
All right, yes. Yes.
Thank you. Any comment on if you have multi-jurisdictions, if let's say 50 or 51% of the target assets are in Greece, but you have the other targets in other countries, are you getting traction and interest from those type of dispositions? Anyone that applies?
I think, look, although we have the two of us and the other two Greek banks, we have subsidiaries in the region as well. Typically, the interest that we get at this point in time is for Greek-specific risk. So this is what attracts the most interest. I guess it is an asset class that is clearly understood, valued, and this is what attracts the most of the interest.
Well, in companies in multiple jurisdictions, I think there are not so many in Greece. But in one on two that they have assets across Europe that we are currently working with George and his team and the other bank teams, I can tell you it's a very difficult and expensive situation when you have a borrower which is across Europe. You have to understand where the value lies, and to my mind this is definitely a case whereby you need expertise and you need to engage somebody who has the operational expertise and the understanding of the different jurisdictions. But there are not. This is not a big portion of our problem because companies with multiple jurisdictions that operate under multiple jurisdictions, there are not that many in Greece.
I would like to comment on the question before on the restructurings. That is what we can assure you, that this is really on top of the agenda. It's the restructuring. It's not the writing off anymore, as it was very much practiced in the first 6 months of this year. It's now the restructuring, which has all of the attention of us as a shareholder of the Bank of Greece, of the Commission in Brussels, of the government, and so forth. So this is really it. And we appreciate the efforts which are being done in the MPL forum and in the committee, which George is now heading, and the initiative with Oliver Wyman, with the SMEs. So we see that as the way forward and not as just writing off, but restructuring, a positive, constructive restructuring, so that we do not see the redefault rates rising again, all of this. No, a constructive restructuring with the parties involved. And I also see the lawmakers helping us in that respect. Be it the judges, which will now or who will now receive training, and also the amendments to the bankruptcy law, and all of this will all help. But restructuring is the name of the game.
Okay, concludes our discussion. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Bye.